Thank you and welcome to everybody for being here. And I just mentioned to President Eisgruber, right after they gave him his gift, they took it right back. It reminded me of the government and how sometimes we get paid the mass sergeant. Would appreciate that. So thank you very much for everyone being here. You know, it was 43 years ago on the 10th of June that I stood here in this very hall with my mother and father out here at my commissioning. And the paintings haven't changed, except they put President Bowen up there. And I don't know when your picture's going up there. I don't know if you're going to wear one of these wigs or not, but you'll fit right in. But that was a momentous day. And I want to thank you all for being here to celebrate the same with your young cadet, now about to be second lieutenant and a graduate of Princeton University, the nation's number one university, in my view. And I think that's substantiated by a lot of various studies. And a lot of that is due to the great leadership of the president, President Eisgruber. You know, President Eisgruber graduated in 1983. He and I have a lot in common. He was magna cum laude, and I was not. He was a physics major, and I was not. He was a Rhodes Scholar. I was not. I was in the half of the class that made the top half possible. So the only reason guys like Eisgruber exist is because of guys like me. So we're pushing up the top. So for those of you who are 2-0 and go, you'd be proud of that. Sometimes the world's run by C students, I guess. So, but thanks for your leadership. To all of you for being here. In fact, we have an incredible group of people in front of you. They're your sons and daughters and grandsons and granddaughters here. But I would like to share a few comments about them. So you've got 14 soon-to-be lieutenants or ensigns in the Navy. And you've got, roughly speaking, different states that are represented. You've got Hawaii, New York, the District of Columbia, which is not technically a state, although some would argue that. New Jersey has got three up here. If you're from New Jersey, raise your hand. Go Jersey. You've got South Carolina represented, a couple from California. You've got two from Virginia, one from Texas. And where's Massachusetts? Where you at? How about those Celtics? Didn't work out, but God bless them anyway. And the Bruins, too. So as a native of Massachusetts, I can say that. But you've got eight states, the District of Columbia, and you've got one from Japan. In fact, five of these soon-to-be officers grew up in military families. And your family is here to celebrate your commissioning. I think that's a remarkable testament that almost 50% of the officer graduates coming out of Princeton University come from military families. You've got 10 men, 4 women, and you've got 3 that are going in the Air Force. One of them is going to be a combat systems officer, another a pilot, and then an engineer. And the combat systems officer, that's going to be the goose of the TV show Top Gun. That's the backseater. That's going to be exciting. Just don't pull the yellow handle. Just don't do that. You've got 3 that are going to the Navy. One is going to be a SEAL, and he already has a haircut, so that's appropriate. You know, you just got to work on the beard a little bit, so we're excited for him. And then several are going into the submarine force, which, just a plug for the submarine, of course, I'm Army Infantry, but I have to tell you, our submarine force is incredible. It is one of the unsung capabilities of the United States military that our enemies know quite well, but it's probably underreported in most places. But our submarine force is phenomenal, and they're going to get a couple of great officers joining them very, very shortly. We've got one going in the Marine Corps. Where's my Marine? Where you at? Down there? There you go. One going in the Marine Corps. She's going into all Marine officers go to Marine Officer Candidate School or Officer School, and then they get branched afterwards. So right now, she doesn't necessarily know the branch she's going into. But she does speak Chinese, and I happen to know the top officer, so maybe Marine Intel might be a good course of action for you, and we'll see where that takes you. I don't know if that's really what you want, but that's possibly what you'll get. So, and then, of course, my beloved Army. And this year is a record year. It's a banner year for ROTC at Princeton, in that 5 infantry officers out of the 7 that are going in the Army, 1 intelligence officer and 1 artillery officer. And everybody, every single one of these folks up in front of you today is going active duty. I've been doing this, as I said, for 43 years. I've come back and forth to Princeton to do the commissionings a couple of different times. And I don't know of any class where everyone went 100% active duty, and that we had five infantry officers, a Marine, a SEAL, artillery, and all the great talent that you see up here. In terms of their academic talent, you know, I talk in terms of competence when I do these remarks to the folks that we commission. And I assure them that they have all the competence in the world. And they do. And we're going to train you when you come in to active duty, and we'll train you in all the knowledge, skills, and attributes it's going to take to be a successful officer. And you've already got all the basics. So in front of you, unlike me, these guys are more like the President Eisgruber sort of standards. Your average GPA here is 3.8. I mean, think about that, right? So there are some people in this room, maybe myself included, who can't even add up to 3.8. But here we are, 3.8. Look, think about that. 3.8 at the nation's top academic university in America. We have two scholars, a Fulbright scholar and a Schwarzman scholar, both out here. Take a look at their thesis. So I had an opportunity to look at their thesis. I went over the archives. And so all the theses here are archived. So I spent the morning over in the archive. It's the first time I spent time in a library in a long time. So I went over there and I looked up some of the theses. And here's one, the quantum cascade laser effects. Quantum cascade laser effects. I'm not even sure what that means. Who did that one? Which one of you guys? Yeah, there you go. A Marine. Holy smokes, a Marine did that. So I'm going to let the Marines know that. All the more reason you're going to go Marine Intel. So here's another good one here. The thermal sensor fusion on bio something or other. Who did that one? Oh, my goodness. All these guys are like engineers, all geniuses. It's incredible. So thermal sensor fusion, and I'll be talking to the, you're going, what are you going, Army? You're going Army? I'm not sure that we have thermal sensor fusion in the Army. Maybe subforce. Maybe we'll put you in the subforce. Here's one about crystallizing proteins in plants. Crystallizing, who did that one? Oh my goodness, dude, where are you guys coming from? Holy smokes. This is incredible to me. So when I was here, it wasn't quite the same. The type of thesis we did were not quite along those levels. That might have been more along the things that you were doing, President, but not the old guys I was hanging out with. So, but this is really impressive. You have incredible talent looking at you, and I can't tell you how proud I am as the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff to bring you on active duty. This is truly impressive. And let me tell you a minute or two about the military that you're about to join. There's a lot of commentary out there in various places, but I will tell you that our enemies know us best, and our enemies have a deep level of respect and fear for the United States military. The United States military is 2.1 million strong, and we are the most competent, capable, ready, lethal force the world has ever known. And that's not just braggadocio, that is fact. And our enemies know that. Right now, right this minute, on an average day, there are 5,000 sorties of American warplanes, fighters, bombers, etc., patrolling the skies of the world. There are, roughly speaking, 100 warships of the United States Navy sailing the seven seas and keeping open the freedom of navigation for the entire world. Right now, we have 250,000, 250,000 out of that 2.1 million, 250,000 of your soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, Coast Guardsmen, and all the other parts of our military are forward deployed right now on freedom's frontier in 158 different countries. To give you a sense, that's just on a day-to-day basis. That's average. And then when Russia illegally invaded Ukraine last year, within days, the United States military deployed over 30,000 troops. And we put U.S. boots on the ground, forces, in every single country bordering Russia, every single one of those countries, every NATO Article 5 country, to send an unambiguous statement to President Putin that the United States was there, we will defend NATO, we will defend every inch of NATO, and don't cross that line. Ukraine is not a member state of NATO, but the other states were. And we put 30,000 troops there, almost a third more of what they had in Europe at the time. We have, right now, as we speak, you've got 4 out of the 10 divisions forward deployed of the United States military. You've got the Marine Expeditionary Units afloat, capable of responding. If you think back just a few weeks ago, there was a crisis, still is a crisis actually, in Sudan, where our embassy and our diplomats were under stress and potential harm. And what did we do? From zero notice, from a cold start, we deployed a force. We put SEALs on the ground. Those SEALs were flown in by Army and Marine pilots on special operations aircraft. Above them, at various altitudes, was the United States Air Force with some serious firepower that could have been brought to bear at a moment's notice. They had Army Rangers on helicopters as a quick reaction force. They had Army National Guard unit in reserve at Djibouti. We had five warships at sea in the Red Sea, ready to do whatever was necessary to evacuate. And all of that was done in cooperation with the Department of State and the CIA and other elements of our government. And we did it in the middle of the night, over hundreds of miles of potentially hostile terrain, through air defense networks that were very difficult to work our way through. And we did it in cooperation with our allies and partners. From zero notice, we were able to execute that, and no one was injured. That's your military on a given day, 5,000 sorties, 100 ships at sea, 250,000 forward deployed, and able to react at a moment's notice anywhere on the globe. And our enemies know that. Your military that you're about to join is incredible. And each and every one of us as American citizens should be proud. But we can't just rest on our laurels. We can't rest on yesterday or last operation. We've got to be looking to the future, and that's where you come in. So we right now are in what I would call a fundamental change in the character of war. And what do I mean by that? The last time that we had a fundamental change was in between World Wars I and II, with the introduction of mechanization, tracked vehicles, wheeled vehicles, tanks sort of thing, along with airplanes and the wireless communication, radios. And that represented a fundamental change in the character of war. The nature of war is not likely to change. That's what Clausewitz talks about, the nature of war. So long as war is a human endeavor, it is unlikely to change. And the nature of war involves friction, chance, uncertainty, fear, blood, death. It involves a certain dynamic between the government, the people, and the military. That's the nature of war. It's political, politics by other means, as he says. It's the enforcement of your political will and your opponent by the use of violence, nature of war. The character of war, though, changes. And that is often driven by technology, not exclusively by technology, but often by technology. In the last great period of change in the character of war, and the character of war is how you fight, where you fight, the weapons you fight with, the DAC doctrine that you use, the organizations you use, how you train the talent. That's the character of war. It only changes fundamentally once in a while. We are in the middle of a fundamental change, and it's being driven yet again by technology. If you think, I'll just rattle off a couple of big ones. Long-range precision fires. We are capable today of striking a target anywhere on the Earth's surface with a high degree of precision, within inches of our aim point. And we're able to sense the environment. We're able to see the environment like at no time in previous human history. So right now, I have a Fitbit watch. I got a GPS watch. There's a lot of iPhones in here. There's a lot of communication devices. You can take it to the bank that any sophisticated country can track the information that's flowing, and probably some countries are probably listening to what I'm saying right this minute. So the ability to see and the ability to hit at range is unprecedented in human history. That in and of itself will mark a change in the fundamental character of war. But add into that a couple of other technologies that are coming at us very, very quickly. A lot of the research and development is done right here at Princeton, which is robotics. Robotics are happening in civil society. You see them all the time. You see them in warehouses. You go to an Amazon warehouse, and you'll see a few humans, but you'll see a lot of robots taking stuff off the shelves. So robotics is coming at us very, very fast. We already use robotics in the military. You see unmanned aerial vehicles. That's a form of a robot. We are experimenting today with surface and subsurface vessels in the Navy. I would submit to you that within 10 or 15 years, you're going to have a partially pilotless Air Force, that most of your airplanes are likely to be robots of some kind with man-machine interface between them. You are likely to see ground vehicles, robotic ground vehicles. Most of our casualties in Afghanistan or Iraq happened in convoy movements through IEDs. In the future, you're likely to see those vehicles being unmanned. Think of World War II and the Red Ball Express, of the convoys that bring up the supplies, the ammunition, the food, the chow, and all of that. Those are likely to be unmanned at some point in the future. So robotics is playing a really fundamental role, not only in civil society, but in the military. And then add on the mother of all technologies, which I would assert is artificial intelligence, the ability to make decisions, the ability to make decisions faster than your enemy. So those are all happening right now. And if you add artificial intelligence with robotics, and you add precision fires with the ability to sense, just those four technologies, and there's about 40 or 50 others, they spell a fundamental change, not only in society, in the nature of man to work, but also in the conduct of war. You're entering into a world that is extraordinarily dynamic, much more dynamic than anything throughout human history. And you are going to be commissioned officers in a military that is going to either succeed or fail based on how we take advantage of those technologies and how we optimize them for use in the military. If you go back to the 1930s, for example, all those technologies of mechanization, the airplane and radio, they were available to every country on Earth, Germany, Japan, Russia, France, Great Britain, United States, et cetera. But everyone mixed and matched those technologies differently. And only one country matched them in a doctrine, in a way of war, that allowed them to overrun Europe in 18 months, and that was Nazi Germany. We cannot allow that condition to obtain again. It must be us, the United States, that masters these technologies. And I know there's great moral issues with the conduct of war, and I certainly want great moral thought and ethical thought in the application of violence. But I know one thing is true, that my country is good, and my country is really the good guys. And I want my country, your country, the military you're going to join, to be the country that maximizes and optimizes these technologies for the future conduct of war. And why is that important? What's this all about at the end of the day? What is this thing that we're in, this military? What are we about? We are about a single thing, protecting and defending a constitution, an idea that is America. And it's about the rules-based international order that was put in place at the end of World War II in 1945. My mother and father, the ones that were here in my commission in 1980, they fought in that war. My father fought across the Central Pacific. He landed at Kwajalein, Saipan, Tinian, and Iwo Jima with the 4th Marine Division. On Iwo Jima, there were 7,000 Marines that were killed in 19 days and 34,000 wounded. My mother took care of the wounded at a hospital in Seattle. And before them, my grandparents' generation were in World War I. At the Meuse Argonne, one of my uncles was wounded. 26,000 Americans were killed at the Meuse Argonne in 6 weeks between the middle of October, or the beginning of October, and the middle of November, in the last great battle of World War I. So at the end of those two wars, between 1914, the beginning of World War I, and 1945, at the end of World War II, about, more or less, 150 million people, 150 million people were slaughtered in the conduct of great power war. And one of the great presidents of this university, Woodrow Wilson, at the end of World War I, tried to put in an idea at a League of Nations, and it failed. And that then led to the discord of the 1920s and 30s, which then, of course, leads to World War II. In 1945, the people who worked for Woodrow Wilson were now in FDR and then Harry Truman's administration. And they said, you know, we just detonated two atomic bombs over Japan, and we just had a war in which almost 500,000 Americans were killed. The world's economy is laid waste, and we can't do this again, especially with nuclear weapons. So they wrote a set of rules. And those rules, written by Americans in a hotel up in New Hampshire, were basically to form the basics of how the world runs today. We all live in a world run by rules, for the most part, that were drafted up in 1945. Those rules are under intense stress. What Putin has done a frontal attack on those rules in the Ukraine. What the Chinese are doing is trying to revise those rules. What the Iranians are doing is they want to overthrow those rules as it relates to the Middle East. So those rules are under intense stress. There were two times before that I'm aware of, in European history anyway, of a rules set of rules that were put in to place a political order in order to prevent significant great power war. One of them was called the Westphalian system. It was put in place in 1648 after the 30 Years' War. When that war ended, people looked around, they said, we just devastated Europe. So they created the Westphalian system. And that withstood for about 100 years, until the middle of the 1700s. 1750s, you end up with, in Europe, called the Seven Years' War, in America called the French and Indian War. And the Westphalian system fell apart, and you had essentially a global conflict between England and France. That lasted, at the end, about 1815 or so, 65 years. They ripped themselves apart. 20 years of Napoleon. It led to the American Revolution. It led to the events of right here in Nassau Hall. It led to the French Revolution. And at the end of it, they said, you know, we really can't do this again. We just ripped Europe apart. So they set up what's called the Concert of Europe. And there were limited wars, small wars in Europe in the 1800s. But they didn't have a continent-wide great power war until August 1914. And then they went through 30 years of ripping each other apart until 1945, and they put those rules in again, a different set. Those rules are now in their 78th year, almost 100 years. The day after tomorrow, I travel to Normandy. And when I was there the last time, I had an opportunity to speak to a young man who was a sergeant in the 82nd Airborne Division in World War II. He was an older guy now, obviously, but he was a young man during the war. And I asked him, like I asked my dad many times, what was the lesson that you learned from World War II? And I was expecting for him to tell me some sort of tactic, 3-second rush, stay low, shoot straight, something like that. And he looked up and he started crying, so he had tears in his eyes. And he said, General, never let it happen again. Never let it happen again. So that is the military you're going to join. It's the military of never let it happen again. We cannot allow this world to devolve into a great power war. The types of weapons that we have that you see on display in Ukraine is a mere shadow of what will be deployed in a global great power war. We cannot allow that to happen. Now, how do you prevent it? You prevent it through the arts of diplomacy. You defend it through deterrence. You defend it through a very competent, capable military that is just, is ethically and morally straight, and it applies military techniques and tactics to defend this country. That's how you deter war. And you make sure that we are the strongest, most capable, most competent, most lethal force. And the theory of the case is, if you have that, and your opponent knows it, and your opponent's a rational actor, then the war will be deterred and you won't have it to begin with. That's the military you're joining. That's your task, is to make us, the military, better every single day. In 4 months, I retire. So the torch gets passed to your generation. And it is on your watch the events that I'm talking about are going to unfold. It's on your watch. Over the next 10 to 20 years, this military, the United States military, is either going to adapt and be dominant in the world of military operations and therefore deter war, or not. And if it's not, then a lot of things are going to be at risk, things that we don't even want to think about sitting here today. So I will tell you that the challenge is there for you, each and every one of you. You're more than up to the challenge. You're a brilliant group of people. You're going to make major contributions, even though your numbers are relatively small at 14. There's little doubt in my mind that each of you are going to make a major contribution to our military. So thank you very much for allowing me to say a few words. Hopefully some of it made some sense to you. I would like to go ahead and I think we're going to administer the oath. Is that what we're going to do next? So we're going to go administer this oath. Let me just say a word on the oath. And this is, for me, what I would refer to as our North Star. For those of us who decide to don the cloth of our nation, this oath has great meaning. It says that we, in uniform, we are willing to die. I've had 242 soldiers under my direct command, not as Chief of Staff of the Army or Chairman, but direct command, some of them not as far as for me to President Eisgruber away, that were killed in action. As I said, 7,000 Marines at Iwo Jima, 26,000 Meuse Argonne, 25,000 at Gettysburg, and so on. We are saying to you, the American people, that we are willing to die for you, or are willing to lose an arm or a leg or to be blinded or separate from our family or to sacrifice for you. For you, the American people. And we're doing that not to protect a tribe or a religion or a piece of ground. We're doing it to protect an idea that's embodied in a document, an idea for which President Eisgruber is a constitutional scholar. It's the Constitution of the United States of America. So we take an oath to support and defend that document, that idea that is America. And like all really powerful ideas, it's an incredibly simple idea. And we take that oath very, very seriously. We don't take an oath to a king, a queen, a tyrant, a wannabe tyrant, or any of that kind of stuff. We take an oath to this idea. And so what is this idea? It's an idea that the Imperial Japanese hated. It's an idea that the communists hate. It's an idea that the radical terrorists like Al-Qaeda or Al-Shabaab or any number of these groups, they hate it. It's the idea that the fascists hate. It's an idea that really forms the very values of our country. It's an idea that says, and it took a long time in coming, and it says right in the very beginning of that Constitution, we the people, in order to form a more perfect union. We weren't perfect at the beginning. We're not perfect now. It's an evolution. We are always striving for that perfection. But what is it we're striving for? Yes, it sets up the form of government, sets up the three branches of government, but it gives us our rights. It does all of that. But really, beneath that, it's the idea that is America. And that idea says that no matter who you are, it doesn't matter if you're male or you're female, you're gay or straight or something in between. None of that matters. It doesn't matter if you're white or you're black, you're Asian, you're Indian. It doesn't matter the color of your skin. E pluribus unum, you know, from the many come one. So it doesn't matter what the color of your skin is. It doesn't matter if you're Catholic or you're Protestant or you're Muslim or you're Jew or you choose not to believe. None of that matters. It doesn't matter what your last name is. It doesn't matter where you came from. It doesn't matter what your country of origin is. What matters is under these colors of red, white, and blue, we are all Americans. Every single one of us is an American. And you're going to rise, you're going to fall based on your knowledge, your skills, your attributes, your competence, your capabilities, your resilience, your toughness, your hard work. And you're going to be judged by the content of your character, not the color of your skin. That's the very essence of this country. That's what this whole experiment in liberty is all about. That's what George Washington did in this Nassau Hall. That's what he fought for in the Battle of Princeton and Trenton. And that's what each and every one of you are going to continue to fight for, so that this experiment in liberty, these United States of America, shall not perish from this earth. So thank you very much for being here. I know you're all proud, and we'll go ahead and administer the oath.